So today, thanks so much for coming. Appreciate this turnout. We have Professor Will Baude from the University of Chicago to present on originalism. And we're very grateful to Professor Sanders from Maurer to be here providing commentary. So Professor Baude graduated from Yale Law School in 2007. Since then, he's clerked for Judge Mike McConnell, Chief Justice John Roberts on the United States Supreme Court. He's been a fellow at the Stanford Constitutional Law Center, and now he's on the faculty at the University of Chicago. So we're very excited to have him here with us. If you join me in welcoming Professor Baude.
So thanks for inviting me. I want to talk about originalism. Basically, the idea that the Constitution should be interpreted the way that it was interpreted when it was framed, ratified, turned into law. And right now, the general debates about originalism, the arguments for and against originalism tend to take one of two forms. There are kind of conceptual arguments about the nature of language or the nature of constitutionalism, and then there are also normative arguments about whether originalism serves some other values like judicial restraint or general welfare or promoting sort of freedom. And I guess I want to try to argue here that these debates have stalled because they miss an important sort of implicit premise here, which is how originalism fits into our practice as a matter of our sort of current constitutional politics and our constitutional law. So first I'll just recap these sort of existing arguments, but I think are important, even though I'm then going to say they aren't enough. So the conceptual argument goes something like this. It's, you know, if you just look at the Constitution, you see that it's a written set of instructions about how to run the government. And when you get a set of instructions in the real world, like a grocery list or a recipe or a map, what do you do with it? You just read it. And you try to sort of puzzle out what the author was saying to you, and sometimes it's a little bit confusing, but you're ultimately asking yourself, you know, what were they getting at here? What were they trying to tell me? Rather than asking, like, what do I wish it said? Right? You don't look at a map and say, you know, wouldn't it be nice if things were over here? And if you went there, you'd get lost. So, under this account, the sort of conceptual account, the idea is to say that originalism is just this almost apolitical, inherently true thing. It's just reading. We all know how to read, and if we sort of put aside our political blinders, that's all you have to do. So that's argument one. We'll come back to that in a second. Then there's the normative argument. This works a little differently, a little less theoretically. This idea is that originalism is just as a practical matter, it works, and it works better than the existing alternatives. So unlike the theoretical accounts about the living constitutional, the idea here is, the idea here is that originalism sort of grounds law, something outside of the interpreter, something outside the judge. So if you're worried about judges having too much power, too much discretion, or, you know, making things up or imposing their own views, sort of democratically unaccountable views. The idea is that originalism provides some external source that stops judges from doing that. Even if originalism often has a lot of ambiguities, even if we think actually there's a lot of room for judgment and so on in reading it, still maybe the idea is that there's something, sort of having something external, something grounded there, provides a kind of a desirable constraint. Or, a different way the normative argument runs is that the Constitution was written by a bunch of really, really smart people who spent a lot of time thinking about a good way to structure the government, and they had a pretty good idea going. And we can see that in the way the government's worked over time, and there were a bunch of things that were wrong with it that they've been fixed with amendments, and that process sort of produces a relatively good, free, happy society. That's the kind of the two ways the normative arguments run. So, and then there are obvious counterarguments to all these. Either it's just not true that reading a map or reading a recipe or reading a grocery list is a really simple thing. Certainly, if you've ever read my grocery lists, they're kind of unintelligible. And what about reading a poem? And, you know, is the Constitution really like that? There's a sort of set of counterarguments there. And on the normative side, there are another set of obvious counterarguments. Is it really such a good idea to constrain the discretion of judges. Maybe we have really good, smart people as judges, and actually we want to rely upon their judgment and wisdom. Or maybe originalism doesn't really succeed at constraining judges anyway. It's just you can find whatever you want to in the original meaning, and so it's kind of a mistake or an illusion. And you can sort of imagine these arguments have epicycles, they go on. I guess I'll say they've sort of stalled out in all that, in all those directions. So what I want to suggest with my talk is that these arguments are fine, but they're missing sort of an important part of the real case for originalism here in American constitutional law, which is what's our actual law? What's our actual practice about constitutional law, like right now, today? So get a sense of what I mean. If you look around at other countries or even states that interpret their state constitutions, you'll see a lot of constitutional debates that look somewhat different than ours. There are some states where there are sort of there's a much more explicit embrace of the living constitution than there is in federal constitutional law. In some way, there's an even more explicit embrace of originalism, but and then in other countries, it's even more true. So in lots of other countries, in France or Israel or Canada, if you look at sort of constitutional debates about their written constitutions, each of our cultures looks sort of alien to one another.
And I think that helps show what's weird or missing from this sort of conceptual originalism is inherently true argument.
These other countries, these other states, they have written constitutions too, and they have a very different way of doing it. So we shouldn't just think, oh, you've got this one way to do it, you've got to read it, you've got to look at what the founders think, or that our practice has some sort of inherent power. And similarly, other cultures that interpret their constitutions, a lot of them have well-functioning, good systems. So again, the normative arguments may leave something unsolved, something to be desired. But, you know, what about our federal constitutional practice? What is it that we actually do with our constitution? And can that help make a sort of more limited, more useful claim here? And I guess I want to say the answer is yes. That actually, if you look at our practice of constitutional law in a certain slightly counterintuitive way, you'll see that originalism really is our law. Even people who don't necessarily think of themselves as originalists may actually be doing originalism without knowing it. And even if that's only partly right, it still has some really important implications. So let's see, the strongest claim would be originalism is the ultimate source of law in our current legal culture. It's not inherently true, there are other ways to do it, but the way we do it really is to look at the written constitution and its original meaning as the ultimate source. To see, you know, that may seem weird, because you may think if you've read a Supreme Court opinion, it talks about a lot of things that aren't the original meaning of the Constitution, so how can I be right about that? But if you define originalism a little bit more generously, if it means looking at the written Constitution and anything else that sort of the written Constitution itself permits. So at the time of the founding, precedent was a part of constitutional interpretation. And probably the best way to think about the judicial power and the things set up by the Constitution are that they incorporate the use of precedent. Similarly, the use of a certain amount of practical reasoning to understand ambiguities, part of the original meaning of the Constitution in a kind of broad way. This kind of originalism is sort of, is to say not that you have to be a wooden literalist about everything or a strict constructionist, but that other methods of interpretation are permissible to the extent they are part of the traceable back to the founding. So precedent or things like that weren't invented 20 years ago, that have always been part of constitutional interpretation, are also part of the original meaning of the Constitution in this sense. And this is actually how a lot of originalists define originalism. So very few originalists would say precedent is totally unpermitted, or that you have to read the text in some way that's different from how James Madison or Alexander Hamilton would have. The idea is their sort of methods constrain the choice of methods. The other kinds of law have to be subordinate to originalism. Once you have that as the frame, then you look at our
say, our judicial practices, and they actually do look originalist. So over and over again, when the court uses methods to resolve ambiguities in the text, they're the kinds of things that have a long pedigree all the way back to the founding. Precedent is the most important, not the only one. There are cases where the court will sort of explicitly talk about how different methods conflict with one another, and when they do, the text never loses, and it often wins. So just as an example, last term, the Supreme Court decided this case, Noel Canning, about recess appointments and whether the president could make recess appointments to the NLRB in certain circumstances. And the court's opinion divided 5-4 very sharply between sort of how much weight to give to subsequent practice and how much weight to give to the text. But both sides of the debate agreed that the text was the starting point, and that if the text was clear, it was the ending point. So the majority opinion is written by Justice Breyer, and it starts by saying, well, we have to look at the text, and only if we discover that the text is ambiguous do we then look at other stuff to resolve the ambiguity. Do we then look at the subsequent practice? And that's what the court said. And Justice Scalia wrote I guess it's technically a concurrence, but it's really a dissent, saying, no, the text was really clear. But they joined issue on this. Justice Scalia agreed that the text was ambiguous, you look at the practice, and that's what the majority opinion said too. Actually, there's sort of overlapping agreement that the text is the ultimate frame, and then practice and other things like that can come in too. And to see this isn't just like a, this isn't a, this isn't a kind of obvious agreement, this isn't something everybody has to agree on. The United States, the Solicitor General, did not take this position. This is a fight he had with the court. One of the first questions he got asked was, suppose that the text and the original meaning of the text is really clear that you're wrong, but we have 200 years of practice ignoring the text, which controls the practice of the text. And first, the Solicitor General employed the time-honored tactic of trying to dodge the question. Second, trying to dodge the question again. But we can only get away with that so long. And so once he was, you know, put to the point, he said, I think the practice controls. Even if the text is super clear, the practice ought to control anyway. And so the court could have said that. I mean, they could have embraced that point. But I think this is the important point, that they didn't. That they felt the need to fight the text to a draw, to find ambiguity, before being willing to go on. And that happens over and over again. In fact, as far as I can tell, there aren't any cases that are sort of currently in our constitutional firmament anyway, where the court openly admits that the text used to have one clear meaning, and for policy reasons or subsequent history, we were doing something different. Whereas with other methods, the court sometimes does explicitly say, you know, I'm going against it. So with precedent, the court sometimes says, this is not what our precedents require, but we just don't care. You know, either the precedents have become unworkable, or the precedents are just so far from what the Constitution itself requires that we've got to reset. And that's a sort of important part of how the court gets itself out of unpromising lines of precedent. Similarly, in the Second Amendment case, Heller versus the District of Columbia, where there's a fight about the original meaning of the Second Amendment and whether it bans forms of gun control, the dissent says, this is going to be, as a practical matter, a disaster. People are going to die because of this ruling. And the majority doesn't say, oh, no, not really. We found some studies that suggest it's really going to be fine. The majority opinion says, maybe, maybe not, but we don't care. That policy judges' views about how useful a right is or isn't just don't matter when the right and the original meaning of the right are clear. So that's the kind of the conflicts that I think you see in various cases where often the various methods of interpreting the Constitution can be made to work together, but when they can't, it's the text and it's the original meaning that wins. That's just looking at our current practice, and that's maybe actually the best description of what's going on. And even if you think that's a little bit of an overstatement, if you think there's a counterexample where there's some area where the court really has gone against the text in a few areas, I'm not sure there is. But even if there is, I think that's still surely true for all these reasons, that originalism is a really important part of our constitutional law, even if it's not the whole thing. So whether either of those things are true, I think this has a sort of important implication for how judges ought to behave. First of all, judges take an oath to uphold the law, and the kind of general idea of being a judge is that we give you a lot of awesome power that we don't give to most people, right? Certainly not to non-governmental officials. Power to order people to be locked up, to order their property or their rights to be taken away. And the deal for that power is that you're supposed to exercise it in accordance with the law, whatever that is. Now we know it's really hard to figure out what the law is. That's why we have legal cases, that's why we have legal debates. But whatever it is, whatever the sort of bounds of legal reasoning are, we expect judges to work within those bounds, not to take steps outside them. So at least as a judge, you shouldn't be innovating sort of constitutional methods that aren't currently part of our law or practice. That also means that, so all this means that originalism is at least a legally favored methodology. It's either the dominant one, or at least it's one of several that have an important place. So to rewind back to our original debates, we shouldn't be asking ourselves, is originalism inherently true? Like, is this the only possible way to read a document? Maybe it is, maybe it's not. I think it's not the only way. We should be asking ourselves, is this the way, as a matter of sort of American legal culture, we read legal documents? And if not, how do we read legal documents? But those are the questions that should be controlling sort of constitutional argument. You know, whether I'm right or wrong about originalism, that's more about where the debate should focus. And similarly, when we have normative arguments about is originalism the best way to have a constitutional system or not, we shouldn't be asking ourselves, like, what's the best of all possible worlds if we were inventing a system of constitutional law, what would it look like? We should be asking ourselves, of the methods of constitutional reasoning that are part of our constitutional practice, our constitutional tradition, which ones are the best, which ones are the ones that work the best, sort of within that legally bounded space. So for the first time, the goal of the practice is to kind of cut out a lot of the more abstract or like fanciful thinking about like what would be best or what's inherently true. Say in the context of our debates, what is it that's part of our constitutional practice? What is it that are the best parts of our constitutional practice? Now, none of this is a complete trump card. I mean, in some contexts, it's totally fine to propose that the law be changed. The Constitution can be amended, the unwritten law can change over time. So I'm not really trying to say everything that we do, we should sort of freeze in place as part of what we do. Law does change. But a proposal to change constitutional law has to be a proposal to change constitutional law by introducing a new methodology that's not currently part of the law has to be accompanied by some account of who's allowed to make that change and why. And for the reasons I just said, I think in general, most people will be resistant to the idea that it's judges who should make the change. Maybe it's popular movements, maybe it's amendments, maybe there are a sort of long list of possibilities. And even if the answer is judges, that at least has to be accompanied with a better story than we have. But that if the constitutional law is going to change and we're going to move away from our current practices, that shouldn't just happen sort of unthinkingly or through drift. But again, it should happen with some account of who has the power to change and why. And until there is such an account, I think the questions on the table should be whether originalism is our method of interpreting the Constitution and whether it's the best of our methods, and not the sort of more abstract questions about whether it's the only possible one or the best of all possible ones.
Thank you. Actually, I learned a tremendous amount reading Will's paper, the paper that was the basis for this talk, and presuming he's willing to share it or make it available, I would commend it to all of you because I think it's necessary to read more deeply into a lot of the history and into the sort of battle for the soul of originalism that I think Will is now becoming a part of. What is the actual understanding of originalism? He demonstrates that it ranges from those who advocate what they've called the old time originalism, a very literal attachment to the text or to the original meaning of the text, what we sometimes associate with the most sort of stout-hearted versions of Justice Scalia, to a person like Randy Barnett, who's much more of a libertarian, whose brand of originalism has to do with reviving the Ninth Amendment and taking a much more libertarian approach to constitutional and individual rights, reviving the original meaning of the Privileges and Immunities Clause, and all sorts of variations in between. And so I guess what I want to focus on is, if we're going to accept the idea that originalism is indeed our dominant mode of constitutional practice, or is the most faithful to what we've actually done, it's necessary to pin down, I think, I worry more precisely than Will has, what actually originalism is or what makes it unique. First, just a couple of points as to sort of put on the table as background. I think that the foil for originalism is often the living constitution, or, as I think it's probably better understood, common law constitutionalism. I don't think Will has intended to do this, but I think that it often gets a bad rap because it's assumed that the living constitution is equal to judges being able to do whatever they want, to impose their policy values, to be legislators. That's the rap, that's the caricature of living constitutionalism, whereas I think a faithful and accurate understanding of living constitutionalism or common law constitutionalism is actually fairly similar to the moderate, restrained, gentle version of originalism that Will has proposed. It is based on precedent. It's based on, fundamentally, on following precedent. It's based on what David Strauss, one of its leading exponents, calls a sort of cautious empiricism and attitudes of judicial modesty, but nonetheless the need to incorporate fairness and social reality in deciding what to do, how to extend or how to alter precedents. So just the first kind of point I want to make is I think living constitutionalism becomes this foil that is misunderstood for what it actually is. It's given a caricatured understanding that's not actually accurate to the way most of the judges and scholars who advocate for it would understand it to mean. Secondly, I don't take Will to be arguing that the Constitution itself incorporates a set of interpretive instructions, a manual for how it should be interpreted. The title of his paper is Originalism, the Law, and there are passages of his paper that I worry sort of imply that that's the case, that to say is originalism the law is like saying, well, when a statute is preceded by a set of definitions, for example, those things are understood to be the law, and they restrain and moderate and guide how we later apply the substance of the statute. Well, of course, the Constitution doesn't have anything like that. The Constitution doesn't have a set of instructions for how it should be interpreted according to what methodology. I think there's a decent argument to be made that in sources like Marbury and the writings of Jefferson and Madison, Federalist Papers, there's a lot of argument. There's a good argument to be made that the founding generation did not understand, it did not intend future generations to be bound by the same knowledge of the world, by the same social facts and social realities that they experienced. After all, it is a constitution that we're expounding, and that anything that was so detailed as to never be changeable or to never require interpretation would have the prolixity of a code book, a statute book, as one of our famous constitutional law precedents. So anyway, I don't understand Will to be arguing that the Constitution inherently demands a particular interpretive methodology. So instead, what he's looking to are, well, what were some of the practices at the time of the founding, at the time of the writing of the Constitution? And we can incorporate those judicial practices into our understanding of the original meaning of the Constitution. We don't just need to look at the original meaning of the text, but we also look more broadly at what judges did at the time of the founding. And so what we get from that, as I understand Will to be saying both today and more deeply in his paper, is that A common law method of judging was very commonly used and understood at the time of the founding, and a common law method of judging is based heavily on use of precedent, and therefore that the use of precedent is okay. If you use precedent, you're still an originalist. Well, a common law constitutionalist or a living constitutionalist would say what fundamentally defines that method is the use of precedent. To be sure, the extension and sometimes the change and abandonment of precedent at certain key times, but I guess I would like a better explanation from Will of how an originalist's acceptance of the use of precedent and a common law method of judging differs from what a common law constitutionalist like David Strauss thinks he's doing or is advocating for. Will, again, in part today and in part in, I'm drawing on things in the paper, quotes approvingly from originalists who argue that understanding text and words at a high level of generality is okay, and there's of course always the need to understand words that were written at a particular time in light of our circumstances today. Well, again, I thought that's actually what living constitutionalists did, or common law constitutionalists did, understood that the fundamental problem with old-time originalism is that the most important contentious passages of the Constitution are written in what Justice Brennan and others have famously called majestic generalities, equal protection, due process, cruel and unusual punishment. What are we to do with those? I don't hear Will advocating the idea that originalism demands that only what was cruel and unusual at the time of the writing of the Eighth Amendment is what can be considered cruel and unusual today. He leaves open room for practical reasoning, for subsequent practice. The text must win when it's clear. But it seems as though all the judge or the Supreme Court needs to do is make a convincing nod toward the idea or a reasonably convincing argument that text is ambiguous. And therefore, as long as you have sort of performed a bit of veneration of the text or the original meaning, actually I'm a little unclear because it at times Will seems to be talking about originalism, which I understand to be original meaning, and other times he's referring to text. And I think it's definitely accurate that the Supreme Court, no opinion has ever sort of explicitly, well, except maybe for some of Justice Scalia and his fellow originalist opinions interpreting the 11th Amendment, no opinion has explicitly sort of rejected the text in favor of some sort of alternative starting point. Even living constitutionalists and common law constitutionalists say, of course, text matters. Of course, text needs to be the starting point. The problem is that the text is just so often inherently ambiguous, and we need to know in light of our settled practice, our culture, empiricism, fairness, what is the best way to understand those words today. Will's paper quotes approvingly from originalists who can reconcile originalism with the result in Brown versus Board of Education, with the finding of gender discrimination violating the Equal Protection Clause. He has originalists who can reconcile Roe versus Wade with originalism. If we understand it, I mean, well, Roe wasn't really rejecting the scoring rules, maybe it just misunderstood the actual rules of the game. Randy Barnett has famously defended Lawrence versus Texas on originalism grounds. And so I guess I worry that the sort of the kinder, gentler, more accommodating originalism that Will is suggesting reminds me an awful lot of what Chief Justice Roberts famously talked about when he was referring to the use of foreign law, or really about the common law method, that it's sort of looking out over the crowd and finding your friends, picking out your friends. I think there's a great roiling debate among originalists about what originalism means. And so if Will is to make a convincing case that originalism really is our settled brand of constitutional law, our settled understanding of constitutional law, I would like to see him grapple more with the originalists, the very well-credentialed, dyed-in-the-wool originalists, who would disagree with him, who don't happen to be his friends or to favor his friends in interpretive and scholarly terms. to grapple with that, but then more fundamentally to grapple with the question, if originalism is indeed this capacious and accommodating, if we can look back at the entire set of US reports and say, I don't think too much of an exaggeration of what Will is saying, basically our entire body of constitutional law up until now is reconcilable with a certain definition of originalism. I guess I worry that definition is so broad that it means nothing. If originalism is everything, it means nothing. And at a more practical level, then why should we favor originalism over a common law constitution or the living constitution when, as I said, I think a proper understanding of those methodologies incorporates almost the same kinds of things that Will has identified as hallmarks of originalism, the use of precedent, the recognition that text needs to be understood at a high level of abstraction, a respect for subsequent practice, using the text as a starting point, but recognizing that it's often ambiguous. I find very little to disagree with in substance with Will's methods and his presentation of originalism, because, again, I think those are the same kinds of things that people on the other side of the debate do and purport to be doing. And I can get on board with an originalism that can reconcile itself with Brown, Roe, gender discrimination, anti-sodomy, maybe even same-sex marriage. I'll close with what I worry is an effect of sort of trying to chart a middle ground to try to find a kinder, gentler, more moderate originalism. And that is, it's necessary to read the fine print. It's necessary to hear Will explain what his understanding of originalism means. This, again, broad, sort of forgiving, encompassing many different judicial methods that were legitimate at the time of founding, this brand of originalism, as long as you read the fine print, is okay, but it allows people who don't pay as close attention to the legal debates or who are not as scrupulous to insist on the propriety of originalism when their definition and their understanding of originalism is something much different. But they can insist when it serves their purposes that we only look to the original meaning, that we only look at settled practices, settled understandings at the time of the founding about what particular words meant, about what was cruel and unusual and so forth. Because you know we've accepted the idea that originalism is our law. Originalism is indeed the best understanding of our settled practice. I worry that that allows all the versions of originalism, including the harsher ones, to gain a credibility and attraction that they might not otherwise have if we didn't have much more nuanced, articulate, and thoughtful accounts of originalism like the one that Will is putting forward. So I hope that's somewhat helpful, and I know Will would love to hear your questions, and I'd be happy to as well if you have any for me.
I'll respond.
I'm glad to have Steve sort of on board.
Actually, I think you're the convert to common law constitutionalism based on your paper.
We'll meet in the middle. So just, I can't answer all the questions, but here, just a few things. So it's right, and this is important to see, that some of what I've just said about originalism is apostasy in the wrong originalist circles. So there are originalists who have a narrower, more constrained definition of originalism. We're calling it old-time originalism. And part of the point of this argument is that they're wrong, too. That's the kind of originalism that's really radical, that says, like, every time the Supreme Court gets something wrong, it has to be undone immediately. Or that says death penalty could never, ever be unconstitutional, because the founders killed people all the time, and that's that. Those forms of originalism, I want to say, are also outside of our legal practice. So they have all the same problems. They have to take account of how our constitutional tradition changes from what it is now to the sort of radical originalism. So there's a right flank over here, and that's right. I think the bigger theme, I like the point about caricatures. I think both originalism and living constitutionalism have suffered from being caricatured in various directions. I think both sometimes caricature themselves, so they're members of the group that take the caricature positions, but that's a sort of, an important point is that both of us, I think, want to adopt a less caricatured version. And so there's obviously a lot of overlap
between originalism and living constitutional. So it's not a coincidence. Jack Balkin calls his book trying to reconcile the two living originalism. That originalism provides a framework for living constitutionalism and they can live happily ever after. So, you know, we just ended all debate other than we just, you know, sort of except for the extremists.
Not quite. So what's different about this kind of originalism from common law constitutionalism? One point is about drift. So the common law constitutionalist account is that sort of at each moment, the precedents have taken you where you are. And the question you should just ask yourself is, you know, given the precedents, given where we are now, sort of what's the next step?
As I understand it, without really worrying about how far you are from where you started or how many wrong turns you took to get there, it's sort of very much just present focus, rather than looking at sort of combining the present and the past. But the kind of originalism looks at precedent. I think often precedent has a lot of weight, but at some point precedents get so far from something that's originally intended or permitted that itself becomes a reason to limit the precedents a little bit or to curve back. So there's a sort of different thought about whether the past matters at all. And maybe more importantly, this kind of originalism means that all these arguments are falsifiable. They ultimately come down to like looking at the history and doing the work. So, you know, is it right that Thomas Jefferson didn't want his views to bind us at all, or did he want them to bind us in a certain way? Those kinds of sources become the place where these debates have to be hashed out. So buying into this kind of originalism is not about buying into a set of results one way or the other. So if you come hoping that originalism will provide the reason to tell you that Roe versus Wade is wrong, or that the Affordable Care Act is unconstitutional, or vice versa, like no promises. So originalism is it's not an answer. It's asking the right questions, it's not promising the answers. But what it means is that then when we ask these questions like, are the cruel and unusual punishment clause or the equal protection clause majestic generalities, right? They're not inherently constrained, but they're also not inherently majestic generalities. Those comes down in each question to kind of context-specific questions about what the amendment was supposed to do and how much space it left open and what the legal practices were at the time. It kind of produces full employment for constitutional law scholars. That's not the reason I believe in it. So just one last example, and that's sort of the next paper I'm working on. Here's an example of James Madison's account of practice and constitutional change, which was something called liquidation to him. It meant the idea was he would say, it's true the Constitution has a huge amount of ambiguities and subsequent practice matters a lot. Subsequent practice can liquidate, let them sort of settle or clarify the meaning of a provision, but it also can't change the meaning of an unambiguous provision. So the kind of the structure was that when the Constitution is unambiguous, it controls no matter what the contrary practice is. When it's ambiguous, there's a range of ambiguity, almost like Chevron deference, and subsequent practice can pick various points in the range. Over time, those might develop sort of specific precedent that helps to clarify one particular path, but they couldn't get outside the range. And to count as settled, it meant more than just that one political actor had kind of seized power and declared victory. The idea was that multiple actors over time all agreed, and maybe even the losers in a debate sort of acquiesced and gave in. Those were kind of the factors that contributed to a settled meaning. So if I'm right about all that, the idea would be when thinking about separation of powers questions or other areas of practice where we have the text say one thing and then a subsequent practice, those would be the questions we'd ask to figure out whether the practice is valid. Is the text ambiguous? Is this within the zone of ambiguity in the text? Has the practice had enough buy-in from all the relevant actors that it's become settled? And you know, is that the sort of consistent with the legal practice at the time? And there's plenty more of work to do like this for all sorts of other methodologies. Those are the kinds of analysis in the fine print one buys into. And it does mean that coming in sort of hoping or needing there to be only one answer to whatever the issue is that's most important to you, maybe an originalism is a disappointing way to go, because there's a lot of work to be done and we don't always know what the answers will be. But I think that's the way to ask the right questions. And now I'd love to get other questions.
yes.
Well, thank you. I really enjoyed the presentation. I really enjoyed Steve's remarks. You kind of took me back to when John Baker was on the faculty here, because John was going to testify for Robert Bork. You remember John was on the NAACP board, and he said, look, I'm going to testify for Robert Bork because Robert Bork is an originalist. And if we talk about the 14th Amendment, I think an originalist position of the 14th Amendment would uphold affirmative action. So I want to go back to your comments about it. The text is clear. It should control over subsequent practices, subsequent precedent. So if I go back to the 14th Amendment, right, it's being adopted. It comes from Congress in 1866. On the heels of the black codes, on the heels of the black troops who fought in the Civil War, we get the interpretation of the Supreme Court in the Slaughterhouse in 1873. All of that suggests that the Reconstruction Amendments had a two-class philosophy built into it. Then we come to Powell's opinion in Baude, where he goes back to the original meaning of the 14th Amendment, and then he says, yes, the original meaning of this was to protect the new freedmen. However, that original purpose has been strangled by subsequent Supreme Court interpretations. It's too late to go back to that. We have to go forward, breaking this two-class theory, whites and blacks, it's individuals, and we can start to strike down affirmative action. So where are you in terms of your originalism on questions like affirmative action, school desegregation? Because
I'm against school segregation. Favorite piece of So the 14th Amendment is but probably the trickiest area for all these questions over and over again. I could just say that. So one strong possibility would be to say originalism for everything but the 14th Amendment, which is just it's funny, that's actually sort of what Alexander Bickle says in his article about the original meaning of the 14th Amendment. That is relied upon by a bunch of justices in Brown, is what he says is, for much of the Constitution that were framed by various framers, they intended to be basically originalist in various ways. But the 14th Amendment was intended differently. It was intended to evolve. It's the best example of the amendment that was intended to kind of always be moving forward. If that's right, and that, I think there's some good evidence that's right, that suggests that this is an area where the specific intent of the framers is the least relevant. That said, I think that the place where the court has probably gone the furthest from the original meaning of the 14th Amendment, and what I worry about as a counterexample, is actually not Baude, but Adirond. So it's not state-level affirmative action that's the hardest to just, I mean, it's not state-level affirmative action that's the most obvious question, but federal affirmative action. Because one piece of the structure of the original 14th Amendment was to say to the states, we don't trust you at all. To do anything. We can't even tell the difference between good and bad, But the federal government isn't restricted by the text of the Equal Protection Clause and is explicitly empowered to enforce it. So you might have thought, and I sort of wish some of the original justices of the court would say something like that, would say maybe states are supposed to be relatively disabled, or maybe that's one possible construction of the amendment. But the federal government is the one that's trusted to protect the freedmen, to make sort of these harder choices, to more send a Baude than you can imagine the story. So that's one possible answer, although it takes us in a different direction to park the 14th Amendment is weird.
This is really great stuff. I wonder if there's a distinction between, on the one hand, sort of the substance of originalism, and on the other hand, the judicial rhetoric that we hear from judges. I don't want to be too cynical, but basically I think you could make the case that some of the examples suggest that to some significant degree this is law office history. So that you've got in Heller, which you mentioned, the Second Amendment case, if you read, at least for me, I read independently the majority opinion, and then I turn around and read independently the dissenting opinion, 5-4 case, both of them purporting to do originalism. Stevens writes a little bit differently in terms of legislative history, but basically you've got two competing arguments, both of them purporting to do originalism, taking them to radically different results. Query whether you really have any constraining effect there, or whether you really have any meaningful sincere inquiry into original meaning. Maybe you do, maybe you don't. On the other hand, I think you're absolutely right that in general, notwithstanding some comments like Justice Powell's, and maybe back in the Warren Court era, Justice Brennan, greater explicit invocation of living constitutionalism, it is the dominant practice to invoke original meaning, at least if you're on writing on a clean slate without a lot of whole precedent or doctrine in its place. So why is that? Even if you take the cynical view that this is law of history, justices still feel obliged to look at the text, claim to be depending on the text, looking to original meaning. And I think part of it is what you're onto is sort of the reverence for the framers and the, maybe not reverence for the Reconstruction Amendment framers, but reverence nonetheless for the episode of the Civil War and the eradication of slavery and the significant change that impelled. So I wonder if sort of the rhetoric at least might be explicable based on history and commitment to history, reverence for the framers, even if maybe this is, a cynic would say the emperor has no clothes, we don't believe you. But nonetheless, there's that strong impulse for justice on all sides to invoke that original meaning, even if it really doesn't constrain them.
Yeah, so I think that intuition and that kind of overlapping rhetoric is part of what drives this idea that there's some kind of ultimate agreement on what the criteria are. I think it's, I don't want to say, my claim is not that every judge who does everything applying originalism or anything else is doing it in the only way it can be done, is doing it in a way that's uninformed by their own biases. So that's part of why this sort of constraint rationale, I think, is not the most important piece of the picture. Just exactly what you say. I mean, you don't even have to look at Heller. You can look at cases decided back in 1789, when it's sort of, you can't help but be an originalist, because you're an originalist. and they disagreed. Yeah. The first Congress disagreed about tons of, Alexander Hamilton versus Thomas Jefferson, or the constitutionality of the National Bank, or the Sedition Act, or whatever it is. So that alone is enough to show that it's sort of like a pipe dream to hope that originalism will produce only one answer. So I guess that's sort of, I accept that basic account. The one thing I'd say is sort of, law office history gets a really bad rap. It's worth noting this is like equal opportunity. Like law office economics isn't very good. Law office morality and philosophy are pretty bad. Like, ultimately, the requirements of legal argument and legal briefing may not be the best place for anything to happen, but it's still the best thing we have.
It feels like you're giving a lot of power to the accretion of interpretive practice over time, right? So saying that practice, or those interpretive methods are originalist methods, and therefore it creates kind of a burden on, anybody who wants to use non-originalist methods. Yeah. And I heard you say, judges should not be innovating in the interpretive methodology they choose because they should be working within the bounds of law, including this law. Okay, so, there are other forms of interpretive methodology. So let's take stare decisis, right? That is likewise a practice of interpretive method that has and been committed to over time that informs how judges treat precedent. And yet in an individual case, there are lots of situations where we will permit, without I think characterizing it as a step out of bounds, we would permit a court to say, we are going to reject this precedent despite our commitment to that interpretive practice.
Yeah.
So what is it about the interpretive practice when it comes to originalism that is different than other forms of interpretive practice that guide judicial decision making but don't seem to create such a hard
right. Well, so this
boundary.
Is exactly it, right? So this is this observation that makes me think that originalism is the ultimate supreme methodology among the others. So when the other methods like stare decisis, judges are sometimes allowed to step outside of them. And often, if you look at cases where the court overrules prior lines of cases, sometimes it's where the precedents themselves conflict,
But when it's not, the most frequent move is we're overruling the precedents because of the text or because the precedents got something wrong originally. So that what it is that in our system, originalism is like the fulcrum on which you can the judges are allowed to stand when they step outside of the other ones. But whereas the same thing, I mean, and that, I don't say it's inherently true. There's no reason you couldn't have a system where stare decisis is the thing you can never step outside of, and the text is when you can. That's the sense in which this has this descriptive power. If I had to guess about like why it happens or why there is that, I think that the reverence for the founders and the kind of original, the story of like this being the time at which everybody set the ground rules and then we all agreed to play within the ground rules must have some kind of force here. That seems like, whereas precedents are something that are come later and are made by the system and are therefore more part of the system. But I don't know whether those are really true.
So I think, I'm sorry, can I follow up super quick? So I think what I'm thinking about are not, like, I want to decouple the stare decisis analogy from constitutional analysis.
Okay.
So let's take stare decisis just in a statutory,
okay,
in a statutory context, right? So, you know, courts have been, a precedent has built up interpreting a particular statute in a particular way, and now comes the moment when a court says this just doesn't work for policy reasons or for whatever reasons, we are consciously going to reject that precedent. Not a step out of bounds, right? So there's something about the interpretive practices in the constitutional context, I think you're saying.
Yeah.
That become part of our law and thus must be observed, whereas other interpretive practices, which I think are also part of our law.
I still don't see
what to argue that simply because because an originalist interpretive practice has become part of our law, it therefore forms this hard boundary when we don't treat all interpretive practices that way.
Right. Although I think I want to widen the lens still in your stare decisis example.
Okay.
If we lived in a world where never before had it happened that statutory stare decisis had been violated, if we lived in a world where precedents were always binding and no judge had ever said, "Oh, I'm stepping outside of them," then the first judge should do that. I think we would rightly say, "Wait a minute, that's not part of the legal system. That's a step out of bounds." So I think you're implicitly describing the system that has two rules, follow precedent most of the time and sometimes don't. And the sometimes don't, you know, is limited and has certain safety valves. So I think the point is that even in the non-constitutional context, practice is what matters. But you have to look at the whole set of practices and everything that's going on. And I think that's what happened.
I really enjoyed the dialogue between you and Steve. I'm delighted to see all this common ground being claimed here. A couple of questions. One, I guess I think it would be especially interesting to identify the points of disagreement of the boundaries, if you could follow up on this concept of drift versus anchoring the text, and identify either now or later real or hypothetical cases where you would say, no, this is out of bounds.
Yeah.
I mean, a 34-year-old becoming president is easy, but not very interesting.
Yeah.
And then the second aspect of this is, I wonder if you could think or talk some about the choice to do a written constitution itself back in 1787 to 1788, using those kind of broad terms. I'm comfortable with majestic generalities.
Yeah.
But as providing some kind of anchor.
Yeah.
Would say there will be limits beyond which we cannot go.
Yeah. No, I and maybe those go together. So this may just be because I'm teaching United States versus Lopez this week in constitutional law, but I think maybe the best interesting but good example of a drift versus a non-obvious anchor would be, you can't interpret the enumerated powers of Congress to cover absolutely everything. Even though there's no clause that actually says that, there has to be something not enumerated, there has to be something outside the bounds. Charles Black, who was like a super nationalist, he actually, even he had one. He said, during the days of the civil rights era, it would have been a great idea, but it would seem kind of necessary and proper if we'd said all state governors, at least in the South, have to be approved by the United States Senate. he said, but as far as I know, nobody ever thought we could do that. Even in the sort of heyday of federal power, that was an example. It's another example off the boundary. So I think those kinds of, those might be a good example of where the hybrid happens, even though precedent, New Deal precedent, has seemed to drift in a direction that was pretty close to covering everything. That might be a good example, but I'll try to think of others not on the spot. I think it's right that the choice about a written constitution is maybe a good way of framing this balance of some rules about some things, a lot more things left up to practice. And part of the frame is that I want to say it's the framers' choices about which things to settle with hard points and which things to leave up to practice that matter, rather than our views about which ones should have been settled and which ones should be left open. And that's how we can tell the difference, the 34-year-old people laugh about, because we can tell that's an example of a hard stop, or the Electoral College, or the various other provisions that don't produce cases. And other clauses we can tell have a lot of vagueness and play in the joints. And maybe a lot of the time what we're fighting about is which one things go in. But that's very helpful.
Unfortunately, I believe we're out of time. We have some students at the classes. So thank you again so much for your time.